द स्क्रीन इज विजिबल। हेलो, द स्क्रीन इज विजिबल। एम आई ऑडिबल? एम आई ऑडिबल?
यस सर।
ओके सो टुडे वी विल डिस्कस द डिफरेंशियल प्रोटेक्शन एज यू हैव आई थिंक ऑलरेडी रेड अबाउट दैट। दिस इज एन इक्विपमेंट व्हिच नीड्स टू बी प्रोटेक्टेड। सो व्हाट इज द बेसिस ऑफ दिस डिफरेंशियल प्रोटेक्शन? इट इज बेस्ड ऑन द फैक्ट दैट एनी इलेक्ट्रिक इक्विपमेंट विल कॉज द करंट इंटरिंग इट टू बी डिफरेंट फ्रॉम लीविंग इट। सो इफ वी विल हैव द करंट विच इज एंटरिंग द इक्विपमेंट एंड वी विल कंपेयर इट विद द करंट विच इज लीविंग द इक्विपमेंट बाई यूजिंग द करंट ट्रांसफार्मर्स। सो वी कंपेयर द टू एंड वी कंपेयर द टू करंट्स आइदर इन मैग्नीट्यूड एज वेल एज द फेज, either in magnitude and the phase, and issue the trip output if the difference exceeds the predetermined value. So this method of detecting the fault is attractive in the cases where the equipment is the both ends of the equipments are not very far from each other and they are physically located near each other. And some of the examples are in case of transformer, then we will have the generators, then we will have bus bars. However, in case of a transmission line, if you take the case of the transmission line, the two ends are very far away, so we cannot use the differential protection in that. So its basis is that we have the current at this side and before that equipment and after that equipment, and we compare the magnitude and the phase angle in both the cases, and then if it is its value difference is more than the predetermined one, definitely it will give the trip command. So before going to the basics of that, we will first discuss the dot markings that are used in that. As you are aware of the dot markings in the transformer also, so I can only give you the basic idea of that. Now let us suppose that we have the coils, three mutually coupled coils. This is the primary winding, and then we have this secondary winding, and this is also the second secondary winding. So let us suppose the supply is provided to it V1, then the current starts flowing in this direction, and as per the thumb rule, the direction of the flux would be like this. If the winding is bound, if the current direction of the current would be like that, then the direction of the flux would be like that. That can be obtained by the thumb rule. Now this flux links the secondary winding, and it induces the current, and the induced current is such that it is in that the it would flow in such a direction to oppose the flux that is phi A, which causes it. That it will generate a flux in such a way that it will oppose the flux that is causing it. So the direction of the current in that very case is like that. Now in this case, you will see that the current is coming from this terminal V2. So we mark this terminal as the positive terminal because the current is coming out of that. And in this case, the current is we have this positive terminal and this is a negative, so definitely we are having this it is the current is moving like that, so we give it positive, though it is a AC. So since the current is moving in this direction, we give it as a positive polarity. So what we do, we place a dot here. Now since the positive current is getting out of this, so we place a dot here, and definitely this also this links the coil, this one, and the flux is current in this case is such that the flux is opposite to that of this flux phi a. So definitely in that very case, since the winding direction of the winding is different from this direction, so the current in this case is flowing in this direction, and as a result, the current which is coming out of this is in this direction, and finally we will have the this positive polarity. So we will give the dot here, we will place the dot here. So in this case, from this we will see that the dot is placed at here, then at here, this terminal and this terminal. It means that these are the terminals of the same polarity, that is polarity in these terminals is same. However, if you place the dot here, then in that very case the dot should be placed here and here. So these have the same polarity if the dot is placed here, here and here, and these terminals has the same polarity if the dot is placed here, then we will have here, and then we will have the here in the C. So it means that when the current enters a dot on the primary side of the CT, if the current enters the dot, as we have seen here, in the primary side of the CT, then the current must leave the similarly marked dot on the secondary side, as you have seen here. So if the current is entering the dot on the primary side and then the secondary side, it will leave for the same polarity. It means that if the currents are made to enter the dot marked terminal, as you have seen here, and dot marked terminal on two or more coupled coils, that is B and C, then the flux produced by these current is such that it will add up. So in this case also, we will have this one and this one. So in this case, whatever the flux is produced is additive in nature. So this is the basis of dot markings. Now we will discuss the simple differential protection and various cases of simple differential protection. Now let us suppose simple differential protection. So under the simple differential protection, we will have the behavior during the load. So during the load, now let us suppose that this is the equipment which needs to be protected. And in this case, as we have discussed, we have used the two CTs here before that and after that. And the transformation ratio in this case is CT ratio is n:1. Then it is then we will have this current is flowing. Let us suppose that load current is flowing through it. So load current is flowing through it. Then the load current is also flowing through this terminal and this terminal. And as a result, it is reflected as IL divided by N, and it is reflected as IL divided by N. So the load current is moving like that, and this one and this one. So the current in both the cases would be same. And as a result, since the current, whatever is current here is here, so no current is moving through this path. In this path, we will have the current which is known as the spill current. So spill current is zero, and the spill current will actually activate the instantaneous overcurrent relay. It's if its value is greater than this plug setting value of the relay. So this is how this simple differential relay work under the load condition. So what we have done, we have the equipment under protection, we will have the CTs, and we will have the CTs are connected, and these are connected in such a way that the whatever the current is flowing is in this before that is equals to after that, and if there is the difference between the two, then definitely it will act as a spill current, and it will activate the instantaneous overcurrent relay if the plug setting, if the value is more than the minimum value. So in this way, and this is the relay, and this will give the command to the circuit breaker. So it is the behavior during the load conditions. Now we will discuss the behavior during the external fault. We will discuss the behavior during the external fault. So this is the behavior during the external fault conditions, and in this case you will see that this is the equipment under protection, and we have this CT used before and after, and this is actually the path and this is the spill current. In this case you will see that let us suppose that external fault occurs within the system, that now the fault current which is flowing is IF external. Now this fault current is actually flowing from the source. So in whole of the source, the current, this source is feeding the fault. Now in this case you will see that here we will have the external, here we will have IF external divided by N. That is, N is the 1:2, N is actually the CT ratio, and here also the same current is flowing. So no current is in the spill path. So as a result, you can see that no current is in the spill path. So for the external fault condition, it will act perfectly. So it is during the differential relay during the external fault conditions. So it is during the external fault conditions. Now, this is what desired. This is where the behavior of this relay. What is desired? That it will not actuate for the external faults. Now, let us consider for the internal faults. Now let us consider the case for the internal fault, and now in the internal fault you will have this equipment under protection. Then in that very case, this the current which is flowing is I2, that is the load current, and in this CT the current I2 is flowing, and here we will have internal fault, that is IF internal is actually the current that is feeding that fault. In that very case, the I1 is actually equals to, it is equals to I2, that is this current plus the IF internal. So you will see that these two currents are compared. That is, in this case you will have I1N and I1 equals to I2 plus IF internal. So it will move like that. Now here we will have the I2N, and the we will get the two difference of two IF internal divided by N. So it will flow through this spill path. And as per the requirement, if its setting is greater than the predetermined, then definitely it will trip and actuate the circuit breaker. So this is the condition during the internal fault. So this is the desired condition during the internal faults. So desired condition, this is what required during the internal faults. Now we can discuss for this is actually a single end fed system. Now we can discuss for the double end fed system in case of internal faults. So here we will have the double end fed system. We have the generator G1. In that very case, we have the generator G2, and the I1 current is there and I2 current is there. Now from this the current I1 is flowing, and from this current I2 is flowing. Now I internal is actually the sum of the two currents. This is the equipment under protection. Now you will see that here we will have the I1 N, and here we will have the I2 N. Now, in this case, IF internal, fault current internal is actually the equals to, it is equal to I1 plus I2. And in this case, we will see the spill current in this case is IF internal divided by N. N is the transformation ratio. So, assuming this spill current is greater than the this plug setting of the overcurrent relay, the relay will operate and trip the circuit breaker on either side of the equipment, that is this one and this one. So this is how it will work during this condition, that is doubly and fed system during the internal fault condition. Now, also one more point, that the minimum internal fault current that will cause the tripping, the minimum internal fault current that will cause tripping, it is equals to CT ratio into plug setting of overcurrent relay. Plug setting of overcurrent relay, that is N into plug setting IPS. So this is about the doubly end fed system. Now, zone of protection. As you are aware of the zone of the protection of the relay, so under the idealistic conditions, you will see that the relay should be such that it should be such that it will trip during this under this zone. So under the ideal condition, this is the zone of protection, that is this zone of protection between these two CTs, that is this one and this one. So this is actually a well-defined and closed zone of protection, and everything that is between the two CTs, you will see, is tripped, that is the circuit breaker will trip if the fault occurs between these two CTs. And this fault is also known as the external fault, and external to that is the external fault, which is also known as the through fault. So this fault is also known as the through fault. So ideally, the differential scheme is supposed to respond to only these internal faults and restrain from tripping external to that. So this is the trip zone, and this is the restraint zone. Now, this is about the zone of protection. However, everything is not perfect and everything is not ideal. So you can say that everything is not perfect and ideal. So so the ideal, if you see that the ideal differential scheme, that is, it should be able to respond to smallest internal fault, but restrain. It will restrain from tripping on the largest external fault. However, this ideal is very difficult to achieve for a heavy external fault current. So this ideal condition difficult to achieve for heavy through fault due to the non-ideal nature of various components involved. due to the non-ideal components of non-ideal nature of various components involved. Now we can discuss the actual behavior of simple differential relay. So this is the ideal condition and nothing is ideal. So we have to discuss the what is the actual behavior of simple differential relay. So in our discussion, we have assumed that CTs are ideal, and in practice, CTs are actually subject to ratio. CTs are subject to ratio errors and the phase angle errors. So these are subjected to ratio errors and the phase angle errors. And these two errors actually depends upon the burden of the CT. That is what is connected at the output of the CT. And this burden in turn depends upon the lead lengths and impedance of the relay coil. So it depends upon the lead lengths and impedance of relay coil. So it depends upon the lead lengths and the impedance of the relay coil. You can say that this error, it will increase with the increase in the external fault current. That is, these errors will increase when the external fault current will increase. This error will increase. So, ideally, what we have assumed, that for the external fault, here we have the external fault, the secondary current on both the CTs, this one, this secondary current, that is IS and IS1 and IS2 of both the CTs are equal in magnitude as well as phase. So ideally what we have assumed, IS1 equals to IS2. That we have assumed in the previous cases that we have discussed. Now, in this figure, you will see that it has the actual ratio is N1 and N2. Previously, it was only N. So it has the ratio error and the phase angle error, that is theta1 and theta2. And as a result, the difference between these two components or you can say the difference between these two currents, IS1 and IS2, ends up as the spill current. Initially, IS1 minus IS2 under the ideal condition was zero. However, if you take it practically, in that very case, because of the errors, IS1 minus IS2, because of the ratio and the phase angle error, is not equal to zero. And the ratio error and the phase angle error that I have discussed, it will increase and the situation will aggravate as the primary current increases. And you can say that spill current builds up as the external fault current goes on increasing. So as you have seen, in ideal case, what happens? This is the primary current. We will have the primary current. And these are the ideal positions for the secondary current. However, because of the phase angle errors, that is theta1 for IS1 and theta2 for IS2, what happens? The spill current between this is there. So we can say that as IS1 minus IS2 is not equal to zero. So this is this is due to the imperfection in the CTs. So we can quantify it through a stability ratio. So we can discuss it through a graph. Now, as we have discussed that as the this through fault or the external fault current goes on increasing, it will increase the various imperfections in CTs get magnified. Imperfection in CTs, it will also increase, or you can say they will, it will magnify. And as a result, it causes the spill current. Initially, the spill current was not there under the ideal conditions. The spill current will also increase. Now, so we can say that external fault current goes on increasing, and there comes a stage where the spill current, due to the difference between the secondary current of two CTs, that is IS1 minus IS2, exceeds the pickup value. That is the plug setting value. So, as given in this graph, you will see that this is the spill current and this is the external fault current. Now, external fault current in this case is increasing, and there comes a point in which this, the difference between the imperfections between these two, because of the imperfection, the difference, we will have some value which is not equals to zero. So it will be such that its value is greater than this IPS, as we have seen here. So as the external fault current is increasing, so a time will come, and there is also increase in the spill current, and time will come, then in that very case, the value is, its value is more than IPS, and as a result, it will trip, because here we have the trip region. So it will trip. So this is the imperfect condition, you can say, and this causes the relay to operate, disconnecting the equipment which is under protection from the rest of the system. And this is clearly a case of maloperation of the relay, because we have the external fault and we don't want the fault, we don't want the, for the external fault, the relay will trip. However, it will trip. So these instances are known as actually loss of stability. That is the differential scheme. If this happens, then you can say that the differential scheme will lose the stability. So the differential scheme will lose the stability, and you can say that it must have the ability to restrain from tripping on the external fault. However, it will trip because of that, and it loses the stability. Now, what we do, we will compare it with the situation in case of an internal fault. So there should be some minimum internal fault current. There should be some minimum internal fault current. This is the limit after which this current, spill current, is greater than PS. However, there must be the situation for an internal fault, that is, there should be the minimum value of internal fault current required for the scheme to operate. This is the current required for scheme operate. So, which is decided by the pickup value of the overcurrent relay. So, this is decided by the pickup value of overcurrent relay in the spill path. So this is the pickup value of the overcurrent relay decided by the pickup value of the overcurrent relay in the spill path. So to signify, or you can say that to quantify the spread between this minimum, I minimum, at which it will operate, the relay will operate, and the maximum throw fault current, that is the maximum fault current at which it operates. So we define the term which is known as the stability ratio. So we define a term, we quantify it and define a term which is known as the stability ratio. So it is actually the ratio between the maximum through fault current maximum through fault current beyond which the scheme operates divided by the minimum internal fault current required for tripping. And this is known as the stability ratio. And higher be the stability ratio, it means that if we have the higher value of stability ratio, then in that very case, this term is higher, maximum through fault current beyond which the scheme operates. That is, this is higher. So it means that this term is higher, that this limit is higher. So then we can say the better is the ability of the system to discriminate. Greater be the stability ratio, better will be the ability of the system better will be the ability of the system to discriminate between the external and the internal faults. So better be the stability ratio, higher be the stability ratio, better will be the ability of the system to discriminate between the internal and the internal faults. And it can be improved. How it can be improved? This stability ratio can be improved by improving the match between the two CTs. So it can be improved by improving the match between the two CTs. So in today's lecture, we discussed the various basic concepts related to that. And we also done analysis for the internal and external faults and what are the imperfections in the this ideal differential schemes. And this everything is not ideal. So there are some imperfections because of the ratio and the phase angle errors. And finally, then we define the stability ratio. So this is all about this lecture.